All right, I've had to sneak in from the back because Rianne's not here and she's taking some leave. So all this technical stuff is left in my hands. Please let me know and I'll check halfway when you're chatting to make sure that the sound is good. Give me thumbs up if the sound is good, guys. And welcome to tonight's show. Let's talk about ice. We're crossing from our new space. I have Rianne with me. Bree, for short. Bree, thank you so much for joining us on the show tonight.
It's my pleasure.
I'm just like stoked to hear your full story because I've got a glimpse of it today. And I tell you guys, it is a story of success and a story of recovery that is going to relate to a lot of people at home, hey? And I really want you to press share on your Facebook today because you see there are people out there, you know, suffering quietly and not really reaching out for help, but you know, you might share this on your Facebook page and they might connect with it and really reach out to get some support and some help, yeah, to change things from a negative to a positive, from the darkness to the light, and to get the support that they need to get their life back, yeah. And that's what we're here to do today. Before I do that, Bree, before we start chatting, and I can't wait to hear your story, I do need to say a few thank yous. So I just wanted to say a huge thank you to Cross Life Baptist Church for housing us and looking after us in this transition period because we have left our old offices and we are on the lookout for new offices. So at the moment, Cross Life have accommodated us and taken us in and we have a home here at the moment. So thank you so much to Pastor Jim and Cross Life Baptist Church for taking us in here. Thank you to Document Solutions for continually supplying our printer and all our needs for printing so that we can print our resources out to share with people what we do and also our resources for the schools. So Document Solutions, thank you so, so much. If you need any printing needs, make sure to go and see those guys because they're helping your community, yeah? So thank you to All Nations Food Van, All Nations Church up in Brisbane. They bring food for our outreach in their van. Don, thank you so, so much for continually supporting the needs of those people that really are in need, are struggling right now. And you bring all this food and you just share it so with us to help more people. So thank you so much, All Nations Church. And thank you to our volunteers, hey? We couldn't do this on our own. I couldn't do this on my own. There are 104 volunteers Australia-wide within AAIC, and every day there are new volunteers putting their hand up to help and to come on board, whether it's in our op shop, whether it's in one of our remote satellite groups interstate, whether it's a sausage sizzle or a fundraiser or even like doing stuff from home, counselling services, and we are just a really abundantly blessed with volunteers. So thank you so, so much to every single volunteer that comes in and helps and gives every day. Some people give 4 days a week, some people give once a month, some people give 1 day a week, but whatever it is, every bit helps, yeah? Every hand helps another, yeah? And you can help today. I don't know if maybe you might not be able to give your time, but you might be able to help support us sponsor one child to get through this program, yeah, through the Australian Anti-Ice Campaign School Workshop Program. Every child, every teenager that we put through the program, it costs us $10 per youth. So I don't know where you're at, but if you can help sponsor, please go to our website. It's www.australianantiicecampaign.org.au, and there's a big button there. It says Join Our Army. You can go on to that and you can make a monthly contribution. Every $10 helps us educate one youth. How many kids do you want to protect against the dangers of ice and other drugs? Yeah, just I'm going to leave that with you. You search your heart. We need to make a difference today for the youth of tomorrow. Yeah, and that's why we do this show. That's why we do the show, because we want people out there to learn from our mistakes, from our journey. And we hope that it gives you tools to be able to help your loved ones. Hopefully they don't get to go there. But, you know, nobody's immune. Nobody is immune from becoming entrapped in this drug and in this world. Honestly, I know that at the age of 40. And I know, Rianne, we had a brief chat. So I want to go back and have a conversation with you right from the start, because you know, not everybody that, you know, people go, oh, druggies, yeah, they've got a whole heap of luggage. They were using drugs from when they were young. They had problems in their life, you know, with their families. They weren't, you know, they weren't a stable family or whatever. You know, there's all these preconceived ideas on what somebody that becomes entrapped in addiction looks like or is like or what their life's like. And mine was definitely not average, and I know that yours wasn't either. So there is no, you know, no average, typical, you know, drug addict or, you know, person in addiction. So let's go and have a conversation with Bree. And I'm so grateful that you're doing this because, you know, we do this to warn and to share, and it's not to air our dirty laundry. Nobody likes to do this, but it's hard work, guys, you know, when somebody comes to share their heart, you know, you're exposed, yeah? So I'm really grateful that you're doing this, and it is to help. So thank you so, so much. So you left your kids at home today, not alone, with their dad, to come and share tonight, and I'm really, really grateful. I want to ask you, you have two kids now?
Yep.
Yeah, what are the ages?
4 and 2 in next week.
Wow, that's awesome. Yep. Girls, boys?
My oldest is a boy, and my youngest is a girl.
Awesome. And I know that you've spoken about your son, you know, the apple of your eye, like they mean everything to
yes,
you, hey?
They do, yeah.
So what's your clean time now?
Almost 5 years.
Awesome. That's fantastic. Thank God for that. But let's go back, and I want to get a bit of a picture of what your upbringing was like, and walk me through like a bit of your childhood or upbringing. How did you get introduced to drugs?
So my life was fairly normal. I grew up in a normal middle class household with my mum and dad and my sister. They separated when I was about 12 and I went between houses then, but I didn't start drugs probably until I was about 21 years old. After my 21st birthday, had no interest in it.
Were your family members like, were they drug users? What was your household like? If you just talk to the camera for a minute, I'm just going to check that our frame is okay.
So my mum was a normal stay-at-home mum for the first part of my life up until I was probably starting high school, and then she went into a full-time government job. And my dad was a mechanical engineer, and he worked a lot. My sister's about 5 years older than me, so she was still in high school also. I have a really big family, and we've always had constant family events and, you know, always had birthdays and parties, big Christmases, big family, very big family.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And it's always... It was pretty normal. Like, and when I say not as normal as it can be with a big family.
Yeah. Well, all families have their ups and downs.
That's
and,
right.
You know, you're not normal.
Yeah.
You know?
That's right, yeah.
So you grew up in, sorry, did you say Melbourne or Sydney?
Sydney.
Sydney.
Yes.
Yeah. So all your family were there and pretty normal barbecues, family gatherings, not really, that was, the drug scene was not really your scene?
No, like, I guess, like any child, you'd party with your friends, but no drugs. So it was more just, by the time I was 18, we're going clubbing and whatnot, and the little parties beforehand, and then it was just normal. Finish school, go to TAFE.
So you studied, you went to TAFE?
Mm-hmm.
And then what happened, Bree? Like, how did you get, you know, mixed up in this world? Like,
So I had a boyfriend at the time that I'd moved out with, that was, as he used to put it, recreationally using, and as I know now, no one can recreationally use, and so I allowed him to say, oh, you know, it's okay, it's only once, it's not going to hurt, it feels great, you know, all this stuff, and I was like, oh, okay, all right, I'm I'll just try it.
Mm.
And let alone, little did I know, that it would just lead to, oh, you know what, it's the weekend.
Mm.
Let's just do it once more. And to the fact, I didn't realise, but we weren't paying our rent on time, bills weren't getting paid, we were smoking every day, if not every second day, and it just spiralled out of control from there.
So how long did it take for you, do you think, to start using every day? Like, maybe you might have used 1 week and then a couple of weeks. How did it go?
Within just a couple of months, I would say. And that's being optimistic. Anyone that's been through it knows that it's so addictive.
Yeah.
It's all you can think about. After a while, it's like, wow, I can't get up in the morning because I need to go have my hit or smoke some or something, just help me get through my day.
Yeah.
And all the emotions, like, you try to just then block them out of guilt and shame and trying to hide it from family, blocking off your friends, and it just spirals just so quickly.
Some people say, and I've been asked this a lot, it's a party drug. You hear people say, oh, it's a party drug. Were you partying on the drug? Like, tell me about that. Is that your experience?
Look, I think you party because you don't end up sleeping, or it's just a night sort of drug. You tend to, I tended to use it a lot more at night rather than the day. But no, I think it was a lot worse than a party drug. Not that I think any drug's okay, but, I think it was much worse. I don't see people that take pills every single day because they were like, I can't live without it. But I see people on ice that literally can't live without it.
Yeah.
And so it's their way of functioning. I don't know how that's a party.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And I totally agree with you. Like, I wanted to hear you say that. People go, oh, yeah, photos, like, you're partying on ice. Well, it's not a party drug. You isolate. This is a means of living, of survival, like air. So you kind of need it to keep going. So, I just wanted to clarify that out there because it's not like any other drug. Yeah, people might do other drugs. No drugs are good for you, right? So not even medicine, right? So they all have their side effects, they all have their repercussions, and certain drugs are more than others, and I don't want to get into any debate about, how marijuana causes schizophrenia, which it does, and today it's being laced with ice, party pills, can kill, and I have personal friends that have somebody that has died taking one pill, but they're cutting it with ecstasy pills and party pills, they're cutting it with ice today to get people hooked. So, no drug is healthy, but ice particularly is, because of the nature of what it does, it hijacks the frontal lobe and the dopamine depletion in the brain, you isolate because you're not feeling good, So was that, tell me about what your average day became like. Like, you didn't have the kids then.
No,
yeah.
I did not. I guess from the best way to describe my feelings and my headspace from, the last maybe year of my usage, I struggled to come out of the house.
Mm-hmm.
I struggled to talk to anyone at all, only my then partner. Not that there was any good of a relationship, but, that's what it was. I was constantly feeling down. I wasn't sure whether, I even wanted to continue living because it was just horrible. And then I was also using all of my money on this drug, and I was living life to use again. That's all I was waiting for, was to use again. And anyone I talked to, and anyone that talked to me, we were just tools for each other to get on again, or to use, or finding a way around not having to pay for something or for whatever the means was, whether it was somewhere to sleep or eat or anything like that.
Mm.
We were just tools to our own addictions,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Mm.
And we talk about that too when we go into schools, that, you know, if you have friends, and you do, like you're in school, you know, you get your friends or whatever, when you start using drugs, the people that you are hanging around with, they're not your friends.
No.
They're, like you're saying, you're a means to either, you know, get drugs or get things or, you know, use each other, really, and it's not, we call them frenemies.
Yeah,
they're not really friends, they're just, and I've seen people dropped off at hospital doors and people left in rooms to die because, you know, their friends were more concerned about what was going on for them and their drugs and their world than being caught, you know,
mm.
and stuff, so, which is really, really sad. So, yeah, if your friends are really your friend, they're going to, you know, they're going to go, hey, you know, don't like what you're doing and I'm not going to support you doing this and,
right.
you know, here's some help, yeah.
Mm.
And if you need some support and you have a family member, somebody that you care about that is, they might be on drugs, particularly ice, but any drug, and you need some, you need to get the message across to them, please connect with us. We do have some training for family members. It is on our website. It's called SAMI Brief, Chemically Speaking 2. It is put together by Optimal Health Group. And George Patrici does an incredible job at teaching you how to have conversations with your loved ones, what tools to bring forward, and how to help create a pathway for them into a recovery program. So we're able to help you with that plan. If you need some support, please give us a call or get in touch with us off our website, send through an email, or call us on 0481 844 555. Yeah, because we do genuinely want to help, because it's so hard when you're on your own,
yes.
You know, especially when you're entrapped in that world and you can't see outside your own, you know, everyday use,
yeah.
You know.
Mm-hmm.
How long did this lifestyle go on for, and what did it look like in your life? Like, what was going on for you? Did you, like, did your family know? Were you living a normal life?
So at first, when I very, very first started, I tried to live a normal life because
mm-hmm.
I thought I could, and I thought, and I was told that I could,
mm-hmm.
and so I believed I would try.
Mm-hmm.
But I ended up dropping out of TAFE, not being able to pay my rent. I got in trouble with the police and the law, and I got in situations that weren't so friendly, as to say. DV relationships, in situations that I'm surprised I even made it out of. Yeah, so I guess I guess that's just sort of how it goes, you know.
So your days, like, you'd get up and you'd use, and then you'd isolate you.
Definitely.
From everyone, and
I didn't talk to my family
mm-hmm.
because I was ashamed, obviously. Yeah. I didn't talk to people that I grew up with that were, and still are today, my greatest support systems that I know are
yeah.
very, very proud of me and proud of
yeah.
Our friendships that we've maintained now.
Yeah.
There's a lot of apologising to do after you get better, trust me.
Yeah.
But
what did they do? Like, did you reach out to them? Did you like still like do stuff with your friends, the ones that were already your friends? Or did you push them away?
I pushed them away. I didn't talk to anyone. Look, I know there was a couple of people that tried to reach out
mm-hmm.
because they knew people that were talking about what I was doing.
Mm-hmm.
And they'd try to reach out,
mm-hmm.
but I'd end up either creating drama that wasn't there
mm-hmm.
or creating a problem that wasn't there as an excuse not to have to talk to them.
Yeah, yeah.
So, same
yeah.
with my family, I guess. There's probably things my family don't know about my drug addiction that I just I don't feel is necessary to need to talk to them about.
Yeah.
But I know after Mum figured out what was going on, she was very stressed and worried, and she just felt helpless.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And how did your mum find out? Like?
She eventually, I can't even remember, I think she eventually found out that I needed to go to court for being found with drugs.
Mm-hmm.
I think she, police had turned up to her house looking for me or something, and that's how she found out what the go was. And that was probably about, I'd say, 10 months before I started on my recovery journey.
Mm-hmm. When, like, your friends were trying to reach out to you and talk to you, and you would push them away, what could you advise people at home, like, that have loved ones that they might be trying to get through to their friend, you know, and their loved one? I don't know, maybe some tips of what you think they could do different, what they could have done different, or some ideas on how they could approach what you think you would have made the difference in the way that you were approached. Would anything have been different, or if there was, you know? I guess I'm hoping that they could get some tips, you know?
Mm.
I'm just going to check the camera again.
Yeah,
I'll let you do that.
I'm thinking maybe a lot of my friends just tried to talk randomly about things. I know one of my friends in particular, she would just randomly send me messages saying, "I'm here if you need me," or "I'm here if I need to talk," or "if I need to talk to anyone." And I think that meant the most to me, and so I did tend to reach out to her. I guess I felt very bombarded by my family, but that was also because I was ashamed of how I was feeling and what I was doing and everything like that. So, and the constant of my mum telling me, "Oh, I'm so worried, but I need you to do this, but you need to do that," it just made me go, "Whoa, I can't sort of handle so much all the time," and it made me sort of push her away more. But then again, you push away the people you love the most,
yeah.
So that is also another thing. I guess just sending them hotlines to talk to,
yeah.
Or like somewhere to talk to online with a counsellor, which I know that AAIC also have on their website. I guess sending all those sorts of things with information and just saying, "Hey, I'm here if you ever need me,"
yeah.
helps. You know, every little thing, "Oh, I'm thinking of you and I'm here."
Yeah.
I guess they're probably the tips I have, yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome. What I usually advise families too is, you know, find one of our shows. Like, we've been doing this for 7 years, guys, you know, sharing every Thursday night, you know, from Bree to you know, guys and girls and mums and dads and, you know, kids and people who have used and been entrapped in this world who managed to come out the other side. And the different people will connect with different people. So find one that relates to your loved one and their story and send it to them. And send them resources. Yeah, send them, you know, somebody who has managed to come out. Give them hope, you know, but don't stop loving them. There's a fine line between enabling and trying to rescue your loved one out of that entrapment, which really doesn't help them. They're the ones that need to seek for the recovery. But you can send them tools, and you can say, "Hey, I love you, and I think you're better. You're worth more than this. That I remember you. You know, you wanted this dream and you had this vision, and, you know, are you achieving that at the moment? You know, when you're ready to change things, I'm here to help you," you know, and things like that, without having to pay the bills and, you know, house them when they're homeless, because they've chosen that, right? And that it's a really difficult time though for families and loved ones. So we have people that will walk with you. We have family support people that will walk with you. They've lived through it, and they're willing to help you with the tools you need and to walk with you while you're having to do those hard yards. But you know, when you stick to your guns and you have the right tools, eventually your loved one is going to come to a place where they have no other option, and we need to get them in that contemplation stage where we can, you know, come in and have that conversation with them. So what was it for you that sparked an interest in for you to change?
My turning point?
Yeah.
So my turning point was I went through the last 9 months of my addiction, really hitting my rock bottom. I was bouncing between houses. I was trying to get clean, but then not being able to. I was trying to reconnect with my family, but then pushing them away because I just couldn't cope with what was going on.
Yeah.
And then one day I went to the hospital because I had lots of pain and I was basically screaming in pain. And it turned out that I was in labour, and then I gave birth to my son probably an hour and a half later. And when they were telling me I was in labour, of course I was like, I am not pregnant, I am not giving birth. And they're like, well, I had to like break to you, we need to get you to the labour ward.
So
like,
you didn't know you were pregnant?
No.
Until like when you went to the hospital?
Yes.
Wow.
And I guess it's just so hard to see through what everything else that you're going on in your life.
Yep.
And all the things that you're doing to your body is making everything not regular or the same as it is. And it's,
yep,
you're already sick because you're constantly using a drug that's not good for you and that has other things in it. And, you know, so
yep,
I guess it's really hard to identify different changes in your body when you're already stuck in this giant black hole as,
yeah,
it is.
Yeah.
And so, you know, the real turning point was when they asked me, you know, do you want to hold him, do you want to breastfeed? And I was like, well, I can't do this, like,
yeah,
you know. And I was upfront and I was truthful and I admitted what I had done. They told me at the time they then needed to ring child services, which was fair enough, that's on me, that was, you know, my life choices brought me there to that day. And, you know, that little boy was my turning point. He was literally the thing that went, wow, I need to change my life.
Wow. Hmm. And how did you do that, Bree? I mean, Hannah, here's this child. Like, so you're in how long were you in addiction, in that entrapment, like the depths of addiction like that?
Almost 4 years, so 3 years, almost four, I'd say.
Okay, so your life was a mess. You're not
absolutely
sleeping. You're using every day. You the vision you've painted. You don't know if you're either a mother, let alone if you're pregnant or not.
Mm.
So you've suddenly given birth to this baby unexpectedly. What was going on for you, and how did you work through this?
Everything. I guess I was in a lot of shock and denial and then grief and anger for the first, well, it took me a long time, but
mm-hmm,
like initial shock took about a week to come off. I spent obviously every day with my son, and I started doing, well, I started talking to the right people, trying to work out what I need to do or what I should do. I reconnected with my family. My mum is and always has been my biggest support. And, you know, she said she'd do anything to help or you know, to help me through this. And, you know, it probably took me about 2 weeks to pick up the phone and to call and say, I need rehab. I need something more than this because I'll struggle too hard on my own.
Yeah.
Won't be able to do it. And my son went to my mum's and she took care of him for the first 5 months of his life. And while I went to rehab and he rejoined me at 5 months old,
mm-hmm.
and I stayed there for 20 months and then continued volunteering afterwards, and you know,
amazing.
Taught me great life lessons.
Wow. I want to get in a bit more detail in here. I know it's a hard thing, and because we don't, we want to tend to skim over the top because it's like some of the stuff is gets really painful.
Mm.
But I do want to, particularly in that turning point stuff, because your friends have been trying to reach out to you, your family as well.
Mm.
You've been pushing everybody away,
mm.
And now you're faced with this massive like responsibility, like I don't know, but. I remember when I was on the gear, I probably would have run the other way. What was going on for you in here? Like, there had to be more than just, oh, yeah, okay, well, I'll change and I'll work this, right?
Obviously,
so, yeah, and tell me about how you coped, like, really inside. Because, you know, it's easier to say, yeah, I took on that responsibility and I recovered, but it's not that easy, really.
No, it's not.
So I just want people, I want to paint a picture for people at home, because there might be people watching that, you know, they might be contemplating change, they might be, you know, thinking about stepping out of that world and, you know, creating a life that they love, yeah, which you've managed to do, but I want them to know what they're up for, and I want them to know, you know, what it took, you know, and what you pulled on. To succeed?
I guess it was always a battle.
Mm-hmm.
Always a battle for a long time. And I cried myself to sleep for many, 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 many nights, probably even after Taj came with me as well, because it was just, it was hard.
Yeah.
And it wasn't easy. And, you know, I guess it was always like, I can do this. No, I can't.
Mm.
But I can do this. No, I can't.
Mm.
And it was like that.
Mm.
And do you know what? Sometimes it is today.
Yeah.
Like, not every day is perfect. Not every day is like, oh, I'm in recovery and I'm doing fine. Some days are flat. Some days
mm-hmm.
I'm great. But it's what you do with those days that make a difference.
Yeah.
But I wasn't equipped with what I am now to deal with it at first.
Yeah.
So, you know, it took a lot of phone calls. It took a lot of, you know, reminding myself and going, what am I doing this for again? And who am I doing it for? And why? And what's the outcome? And is it really worth it? Am I worth it? Is it beneficial to my life? Like, what's it really going to do? Is it going to change anything? I guess also in saying that, I had to talk to a lot of other people around me that I didn't know that well from the rehab and things like that, and go, how long have you been clean for? How long have you been here? Like, what's your story? Am I going to get through this? Because right now I don't think I will.
Mm.
And it's so hard. I remember when I was first there in my first few days of rehab, someone who had completed the program spoke about their story, and it gave me so much inspiration and hope. And I know that during those hard times, and still to this day, I think about that person and the many people after her that truly spoke to me and go, I'm going to be like them one day, and I'm going to make it that far, and I'm going to keep going, and that's who I want to be. And I want to do it for myself. At first it was for my son, but then eventually it was like, I'm worth this, and I need to do it for me.
Yeah. That's amazing. I love you actually pouring out your heart now, what was going on for you inside. You know, and you are worth it. You know, you are worth it. And your son's worth it, and your life is worth it. And you at home, you know, I don't know if Bree's talking to you. You know, you might be hearing this and thinking, yeah, well, you know, I've got a couple of kids, you might not have them at the moment, or you might have a child on the way, or, you know, you might not have a child, but you are worth having a life worth living. You know, it's not easy, but then life's not easy, And, but going down, you know, with that dis-ease of using that drug, it only brings negativity onto you, your life, your mind, your your family, your, you know, everything. It doesn't bring life, you know. And so choose life so that you can live, you know. And you know, get it, take control for yourself, you know. There's so many people waiting to help you. You know, we are here. There are so many resources waiting to support you to step out of this space. You know, it's really unfortunate. I have people that, you know, I've tried to help in the past who have had their children taken off them. And I thought that when they gave birth to this child that this would have been their turning point.
Mm.
But it wasn't.
Yeah.
You know, what, there must have been something that you just grasped onto inside.
Mm.
Was there a vision? Was there a dream? Was there a... I don't know.
I guess I reminded myself that my child didn't choose this life. My child doesn't deserve to grow up without parents or with his grandparents or without me in his life, or and being disadvantaged in that way, you know. And I have to keep reminding myself of that. You know, he didn't deserve it. He didn't ask for it.
Yeah.
You know, it wasn't his choice.
Yeah.
So I did what I had to try and, you know, give him what he deserved. Because, yeah, that's what you should do.
That's
what I feel I should have done.
That's
what
you should do. That's beautiful. And that is so true.
Mm.
You know, it's not the child's fault. So, you know, you can break free from this addiction and that entrapment. You can. And, you know, we want to help you do that, guys. You know, you may be contemplating change, but, you know, you're worth the change. You know, it's difficult for a period, and it does get easier every day, right?
It does. It comes in waves.
Mm-hmm.
Let it,
but life is, like, everybody has, like, waves in life, you know?
Mm.
When we're talking schools, like I said to the kids, you know, in this world you're going to have trouble. Trouble's part of living, you know? But we have to learn to be overcomers of trouble, right? So you overcome those obstacles, and then, you know, you get stronger, and you succeed, and you win another battle. And this is life, you know. Some days you're not going to want to overcome anything, and it's all right to sit there and, you know, have a day off. But generally, an option of running away or trying to mask that, it doesn't help, it doesn't work.
No.
It only brings pain, hey?
Yeah, that's right.
Tell me about your life today.
My life today?
Mm. Not today, but like today, clean.
Yeah, clean.
And out of rehab. What does
yeah.
that look like?
So when I got out of rehab, you know, I got a place for just me and my son. And then I met my daughter's dad. Which we've now been together for 3 years or so. And I told him, look, this is my life. My child comes first. If this isn't right with you, then we should just let it be. He is also one of my biggest supports these days. And he's fantastic. He's great with my son. He's great with our daughter. He supports me in whatever I choose to do with life. He supports me in recovery. We have a healthy relationship, which I can't say I've had for a very long time.
Yeah.
And it's just, he encourages the connections with friends, with family, with studying, going where I want to in life.
Mm-hmm.
And when I told him about this campaign and coming to speak and stuff, he was my first like person to go, oh, that's amazing, that's so great, like do what you need to do because it's a wonderful thing that you're contributing to. And it is,
yeah
definitely.
It's by giving that we receive,
mm.
you know, and we can take what tried to destroy us and carry that around as a baggage and say, these are my scars, you know.
Yeah.
Or you can take it and you can use it for good. Yeah, just teach others, hey, you don't want to walk down this path, man. I've got a limp on my foot now because I've sprained my ankle on that hole in that pathway, and man, you don't want to go there. So you can take that and just you know, use it and help others, like, get up out of the hole, you know, and say, you know, come here, I've been there, fell down there too, but you know what? I learned to walk like this. And, you know, we were made to do life together, guys, you know, and, you know, God made us like that. And, you know, with all our warts and everything, everybody has something, yeah? But we get up again and, you know, we chink arms and we do life, yeah? And so if this is you we're talking to, I don't know, you might be watching the show and going, hey, I don't fit in anywhere. You know, you don't understand, I've been through this and I've got a criminal conviction or I've done that and I just can't forgive myself. You know, get up. Get up. You know, there is hope out there. You can make a difference. You are worth it. And, you know, we're a family at AIC. And we're working in the schools and prisons and workplaces. You know, we're helping people in addiction get into recovery programs, supporting them, being their buddy. You know, it's when you haven't got a, and your brain's not working, from that world, to have somebody that really cares about you, be your brain for you, say, no, don't make the choice, make this choice, it's better for you, because I've tried that, but this works, right?
Yeah.
It's so much easier, you know, and that you would have had that in rehab, you would have had people walk with you and say, oh, if you go that way, your choice at the end of the day, but if you choose that, this is what you're going to get, but if you choose that, this is kind of maybe suitable better, and then you go, oh yeah, I didn't see it like that, you know, and that's what rehab's about.
Yeah.
You know?
Where I went to rehab, it was very confrontational, based on behaviours to help you get to the root of why you started in addiction in the first place.
Yes.
And we found the confrontation as tough love, and it was, and it was hard. And sometimes you just wanted to stand up and walk out, but you couldn't. You sat there and you'd listen.
Yeah.
And sometimes that's the hardest thing to do, is listen.
Yeah.
But know that they're only saying that because they care, you know, and then you have to learn to respond to it. And that's probably the hardest thing coming out of addiction, is not reacting.
Yes.
And I guess learning to respond and know, you can go to someone, hey, I don't like that you're doing that. That's not good and I don't think that's okay, is probably one of the best things I learned to be able to do, because I do it with people in my life all the time. They go, oh yeah, cool, thanks, you know, and people can do it with me, and I thank them, because it's only helping us become a better version of ourselves.
That's so good. That is so good.
Yes,
because
definitely.
There's so much we don't allow ourselves to do. Yeah, and listening, it's funny you talk about listening, because I heard today on a podcast, those that listen grow.
Yeah.
And I went, I've got to listen more. I talk a lot. Those of you that know me. So it is when we listen. And you're absolutely right. Responding correctly. Our clinical director, George, he always says, you know, keep your emotions. Emotions are there as a sign of a warning that something's not okay.
Mm-hmm.
But we should never live our lives with our emotions leading, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
We should always put our emotions in the back seat of the car with a seatbelt, preferably two, restraints in the back seat. And it's a sign, hey, something's not right, but you don't let it lead your life. You can't react based on your emotions, because they're not always, you know, safe.
Yeah.
But just let it sit there and go, okay, something's up, and then process that and look at it, you know, rationally when you're relaxed and not so you know, emotional about things, yeah?
Mm.
And that is hard.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, yeah.
Definitely.
How did you do rehab with the baby? Because there's not many of that.
I guess.
How was it?
At first, I did about just over 4 months without him. So that gave me time to sort of adjust, I guess, and learn the routine of the place and get through the initial part, which is actually probably the hardest part, is taking the steps and entering and going, I have a problem and I need help with it, you know. And I guess once my son came in, I then had to relearn everything. And then I had to manage that while being a parent as well. My days got longer. But thankfully he went to daycare for a couple of days a week, so that I was still managing to do my group sessions and counselling and my own treatment and things like that as well. It wasn't easy.
One would imagine. That sounds it's hard enough doing rehab, let alone a child.
I think
so. Did everybody was he the only child?
No.
Oh, yes.
So I was in a part of the program that had a parents and children's program. So there was sometimes up to, I'd say, six other parents, not so often, probably four other parents is about an average.
Yeah, yeah.
I did go through the program with one other person in particular, and my son grew up with his son, and they are still friends today.
Oh, wow.
Yes, and I guess it's about then finding another way to relate to other people and finding another way to help you through recovery as well.
Mm.
And it was just a whole other group of things, learning to parent in recovery and then learning to live in recovery.
Yeah.
And still manage all the support networks and your treatment at the same time.
Wow.
And the training together.
Wow, that's amazing. I think you're amazing. I really do. It's hard enough, getting yourself in recovery, let alone learning how to parent at the same time. The levels, the dynamics and the levels of that is just far out. It's just, my hat goes off to you, honestly. Guys, honestly, if you are contemplating, getting some help and getting recovery just on your own, if you can't learn something from this amazing lady here, she's been able to do it, yeah, with a child at hand, right? So if she can do it, so can you, yeah? So it's always support, and once you start embark on it, you find that, the pieces and people and things come together, right?
They do, yes.
Wow.
Yes.
What was the best thing about recovery? What's the best thing about recovery? Not what was or what is?
I guess feeling free. That's, I guess, being able to feel free. There was one point in my life where I couldn't see how I was going to get through to the next day, and I couldn't see what the point of being here was. I couldn't see past the next couple of hours and what was going on just then in that moment. And I guess feeling free to live life and to have more choices now than I had in addiction, I didn't think that was possible. I didn't think life like this was possible. I go on family holidays now.
That's
awesome. I didn't think I would say that just 6 years ago, So being able to live and have a house and have a family and love and support is the greatest thing.
I can feel you, and it just choked me up, because I could feel you, her energy matter, and so I feel the joy in that for you, and it is, it's just, from what, going back to that space where it was the deepest, the darkest place where you never thought you would get out of, and now to be in this space is such a contradiction, the other side, but you've done it, and you always, you go from glory to glory, you go from life to better, you just got to stay focused, and it's not perfect, right?
No.
Life's not perfect, right?
No.
I'm sure you guys argue and you get fed up, and
that's right.
It's just called life, it's just called being human, and it's okay,
that's right.
And it's okay, so you're going to have little dips like that in life, but it's not going to be all the way down all the time, staying down there. Recovery is a lifelong thing, but it does get easier every day. And we have amazing people around you and us all the time that, we learn to do life together. which one was their wart, you know? Some are worse than others. Guys, you know, if you want recovery and we're speaking here and you're getting hope and inspired, you might be thinking, you know, maybe I can reach out, maybe I might want to give it a try. Maybe I would just even contemplate talking to somebody and seeing what my options are, yeah? If that's for you, you're thinking that, I want you to connect with us. I want you to reach out. You know, whether you private message us on this show now, or whether you send through an email off our website, or whether you call our support number, or send through a text message, 0481 844 555, or 1-800-NO-2-ICE on our national call line. You can give us a call and we'll connect you to a person in your area that can support you. Yeah, but we want to see you get your life back. Okay. So Bree, if there are any last minute things, because we do have to wrap up, any last minute things that you want to share for people at home? Any last minute messages, you know, that you want to share? You know, we've got families watching that might be wanting to help their loved ones. We've got people in recovery that are watching that are going, hey, I'm in early stages. Then I hope that my life turns out like that. We might have people that have been sent this link that haven't even stepped into recovery yet.
Yeah.
And we might have kids in schools because they come onto the show as well sometimes and they watch to learn what not to do and what how to get out of stuff.
Learn from our mistakes.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
But, you know, if there's anything that you want to share with people at home today, is there anything you have?
I guess just know that your life is worth it and it does get better. It does. And if I am any living proof to anything, I could do it, and I believe so many other people can do it too, and it does. It just gets better.
Mm-hmm.
It really does. And you just gotta get through the hard initial part of it all.
Mm-hmm.
And it's okay to ask for help.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Guys, I am so stoked to say that Bree is coming on board with AARC and we are going to be working together to go back into the child safety, into the parent, to parents, to be that person that, you know, can help support you, yeah? Whether it's on the phone, whether you're blessed to have Bree by you in the future. I don't know, but you know, we're working together. We're really, 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 really blessed to have you join our family and be part of this organisation. So, I'm stoked at what you've been through and you've come out the other side. It's just awesome. So, thanks very much for being on the show.
Thank you.
Can I teach you our Not Even One symbol?
Sure.
You guys know it at home. Do it along with us. You ready? It goes N. It's not even.
Even.
Once. You ready? Not even once. Guys, take care, stay blessed, stay clean, and we'll see you next week. Good night. God bless.